Welcome everybody to the In Conversation with Djordje Ozbolt and Oliver Basciano tonight. This is actually, I think, the first talk that we've held in the Threshing Barn, so it's really exciting, and to be able to be amongst Djordje's exhibition here, Brave New World.
Thank you.
If you haven't sort of seen the exhibition or want a kind of a further in-depth view, we're doing an exhibition tour on the 28th of April. But tonight we're really excited because we're launching this new monograph of Djordje's works over the last 4 years, which Oliver Basciano, who's the international editor of Art Review, has written the essay. And it's just a fantastic book, which we've also today launched the keychain gnome, which you'll see matches this one right here. So also just to say that the shop is open until 7:30, and without further ado, Oliver and Djordje.
Thank you. Is this working?
This is working.
Yeah?
We're here. Two people in a room.
Yeah.
Lots of other people in a room looking at us. So, thank you for coming.
Thank you.
This is going to be a relaxed conversation. Or maybe not. Maybe we'll get into a fist fight.
Maybe we'll get furiously angry. I'm sure it's going to be...
And we welcome that too, as well.
Absolutely.
I met Djordje a few months back at his studio. Chaotic studio.
Yeah, chaotic.
I'm not going to pretend otherwise. Talked a lot. And one of the things that I began to think about and wrote in the essay, and then walking through the show, that becomes very apparent, are all the monsters, Djordje.
The monsters?
There's monsters. But are they monsters? Do you think of them as monsters?
I don't think of them as monsters. I don't see them as monsters.
Because that's negative?
No, because I don't think of them as monsters.
What are they? What are the dear people in the sculptures?
The sculptures? I don't see them as monsters at all.
Who are they?
I see them more like some deities or semi-gods that I created, you know, through the process of... I mean, I used to make sculpture in a way that I would have an idea because I trained as a painter, but I did sculpture as well. But I used to have an idea and then make a model or a sketch and then send it to someone who can actually produce that, because I wasn't good with the different materials and I didn't have all the knowledge to be able to produce them myself. And these sculptures in this show are the result of going back to kind of process and making it myself from the, you know, from the idea to the to the final thing. But
where do the materials come from?
The materials, interesting question. The materials come from, I mean, I just decided to make sculptures without any ideas of what they're going to look like, or, you know, I didn't have an idea of a final piece and then made it. I just decided to start with the process and see what comes out. And that was the result of that. And it was a long process because I had all the time in the world doing my residency at the Maltings here in Bruton. Sorry. And I just started with the materials I had around because I thought it's the same thing as, you know, a piece that I made in the same way. You know, the final piece would be the same thing as if I had a preconceived idea and send it to someone to make it. But I wanted to get back into the process of making it and see what comes out of the process. And these things were the, you know, it started off with different materials and I was playing around, and then I, through that process, I narrowed it down to a few things that I got kind of, that I found more interesting than the others, and that was the final result. It all ended up with the builders built with the foam, expanding foam and spray paint, and a few pieces of wood and stuff.
Do you think that those, I mean, one could ask this question about any work underwear, but do you think those works could have come about in London, or were they under a protracted time span? Or
no, not in the way that in London I have less time, I think, studio time, and less time to kind of experiment in a way.
You have a family, a dog, you know?
Yeah, of course.
Like, all the responsibilities all of the a human being?
Like. Yeah, of course. Well, being an artist is just another job, I think. Mm-hmm. You know, you work and you have other things to do. I mean, there are lots of artists who kind of... how would I say it? Who see art as a kind of their whole life and the whole world. And I'm not one of them. I like to kind of switch off from time to time. And especially with the family, I can't really... I have to be a father, and I have to be a husband, and I have, you know, other things to do. Successfully or unsuccessfully, I'm not going to go into that. But you know, I like to switch off from being an artist. So being an artist is in the. I mean, I still think about art. I think that's the kind of common thing in artists. They never stop thinking about art or what they're doing, and you know, it's always there. But
I see how certainly being an artist is another job, but I have a job.
Yeah, absolutely.
A lot of people in this room have jobs.
Yeah.
Most of us, our jobs aren't making gods, and you're making gods.
Well, in this particular case, but otherwise,
I know, but
yeah. Well, it was just the result of this process of experiment, and I ended up with these things that resembled, not the final pieces, but the pieces in the process started resembling something I've seen in India. Mm-hmm. And Sai Baba, but not the last one, the original Sai Baba with the bandana. And they reminded me of that, and they then, you know, so subconsciously I ended up making them in that kind of image. Mm-hmm. I mean, to an extent, in my head it was that, but you know, when you look at them, it's obviously not exactly accurate portrait of Sai Baba. Not that I'm a Sai Baba follower or anything, but I've go to India all the time, and I kind of quite familiar with their culture to an extent, I think, and religion as well.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting how, you know, misrecognition of them as monsters or what have you to gods, because we're talking, I suppose, about different cultures or different subjectivities.
Yeah. In India, you have Shiva, one of the gods, who is a god of creation and destruction.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's the same thing. So you could call him a monster and,
of course,
a god. So one man's, be good and bad. You know,
one thing. Man's god is another man's monster.
Absolutely, as we all know by now. You know,
what I suppose I was interested in was the idea of the subject reading, misreading, reading.
Yeah.
Once something leaves your studio, of course, you have no. You relinquish control to an extent.
Yeah.
So in the next room through, we have various other icons of other cultures.
Yeah.
That some I recognize, some I don't. Some maybe I think I recognize, but I'm you know, conflating icons. What happens when you pull an icon, a god, a figure from one culture to another? Into a figure from India or a figure from Easter Island, and he arrives, she arrives, and sits in Somerset.
I don't think it's important in religious terms or in any kind of, you know, there is no, it's just a part of the piece. Mm-hmm. And I don't think he says it has a religious significance, or it's not a comment on that. It's part of this idea that I try to present, and if it's appropriate, I'll take anything, you know, from any culture to make the piece of art. But I don't think there is a religious or any mm-hmm. other significance. It's just an image.
I suppose
of a sorry. Yeah.
Sorry, no.
No, go on.
No, please.
No, sir, please.
I suppose it was like the idea of recognition of one's, of what, do these works individually have specific readings that when you put out there?
But they do in a way, but I don't, as you say, once they leave, I don't have control over that, obviously, and I don't try to kind of impose any specific reading through over-explaining the piece mm-hmm. of any of these pieces. I leave it to people to see mm-hmm. it. And there is, for me, there is always a visual element as well, especially mm-hmm. in the paintings. I think in sculptures as well. Mm-hmm. But I think visual is very important. That cuts out all the conceptual or idea or anything. So I mean, the way I work is quite, how would I say, I don't overthink mm-hmm. things in the process of making. I might subsequently look back and think about it more, but when I'm making it, I leave it to my, more. I might have a starting point, but then I leave it to my kind of subconscious to take me somewhere. But I think inevitably I'm, you know, my concerns are the visual impact at the end mm-hmm. and the colors and the way it's painted mm-hmm. and things like that. I think it's more interesting for me personally. It's more, I don't think it's generally more interesting, but for me, my work, I see it as more interesting if you don't control it too much. Mm-hmm. So the process is important, I think, as well, because in the process, from the starting idea to the final piece, you know, there is a process, and in that process I allow mistakes and, you know, things to happen, which I usually embrace and leave them in the work, you know, the scale, the badly painted or not accurate, or, you know, I don't mind those things, because I think ultimately at the end they just add to the piece, in my view. I'm mm-hmm. not, you know, it's up to,
because I can imagine, you know, if one's painting a recognizable figure like Bambi, or
yeah,
as opposed to a figure that isn't recognizable, a monkey drinking beer.
Yeah, but these are, yeah,
I know these are from
these beers, are from yeah. beer adverts, all the yeah.
But Bambi being
Bambi,
an iconic,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah,
I can say, I could look at that and say, make a judgment of whether you've correctly. I mean, we were talking earlier yeah. about correct painting.
Yes.
And
what is the painting?
The ridiculousness of that
yeah.
statement.
Yeah. Or the ridiculousness of painting.
Well, what is the ridiculousness of painting?
I don't know. You know, painting is a funny medium. Because, I mean, any art kind of medium is, you have a, you know, blank canvas, and then you start there, so anything goes. Mm-hmm. The possibilities are endless. I mean, it's a cliche, of course. I'm repeating the kind of known. But that's what you're faced with as a painter. It's always, you know, the next one is the blank canvas. You can leave it blank, and that's a painting as well. Conceptually, kind of heavier than if you apply something. But there is always that, you know, the facing the blank mm-hmm. canvas and then decision making, and that's where you come in as an artist.
Well, I mean, in the essay I spoke, and of course writing has a similar facet.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Staring at a blank page. And you have, I mean, I'm lucky I have a thing, a subject, your work to write about. But one still is staring at a blank page, and so one catches on to something. And the way I wrote the essay is I caught onto your bookshelf in your London studio. Yeah. Started from there.
You just seen one because the other one was covered with, I mean, behind the paintings.
I missed half your books.
You missed
extraordinary
more than half
of books.
The books. Yeah.
Gosh. And I know that sometimes you recourse to that, though, for motifs, visions and stuff. And I think we should talk about that. But I'm also interested in when you came, you're away from home, you're away from that studio, you're here, where presumably you didn't cart a box of books down.
No, well, I sent a couple of boxes here but a random selection of mm-hmm. books. Because that's how I work. I don't have a, you know... I mean, for the show in Holborn, in Bath, I had a show in a small museum in Bath before this show. And that was different in a way that it was a response to the specific thing, and it was a response and a kind of a dialogue with the existing collection of the museum, which I don't know how many of you have been to Bath, to that museum. It's quite an old school museum, quite a nice museum, great. But my idea was to show my paintings along the collection, so not in a separate room, but to create some kind of a dialogue and response to the collection of the museum. So that was a different way of working for me because I've never done it before. I went to the museum quite a few times and I got some images of the existing works in the collection, and then I worked around it, so I didn't need my books. Mm-hmm. I had all the ideas and imagery from the museum. But with this show, I went back to my way of working, which is mm-hmm. quite eclectic and no starting point. I mean, I might have a idea of a title of a show or mm-hmm. a title of a work before I have any idea of what the work is going to be about or what it's going to look like. So where were we? Sorry.
I mean, you said a random selection of books, truly random? Like,
random to an extent. There is loads of catalogues of, old masters auctions in London. I quite like those. But apart from that, very random. I source them from, there is no, mm-hmm. I just get them. Mm-hmm. Whatever catches my eye, and what it could be a, charity shop. And I mean, I see it as really eclectic mm-hmm. selection. I quite like to keep it that way, and mm-hmm. That's the way my brain works. I can't kind of focus on one thing necessarily and then, pursue it, mm-hmm. That one thing and then push it as some artists do. But I quite like to start fresh, I mean, to a point, because even that eclectic approach, I'm sure after a while, creates a style or
of course
is recognized as eclectic, which is becomes a style. You see what I mean? That's how I work.
And those books presumably aren't totally random because they've been picked up by you.
Yes, well,
something has been attracted.
Yeah, we're getting into philosophy now, psychology. No, but
of course. On the couch.
Of course. Lie down. Yeah. No, but it is. It's they were picked up by me, but random. I mean, I don't know. I see it as kind of just randomly, mm-hmm. whatever mm-hmm. catches my eye. I mean, I used to read a lot, and I used to read papers and magazines and. I don't read much now. I mean, I read books, but I don't read any. art? Well, no, I'm topical kind of things, you know. I've gone off the daily news and the politics, but I used to be really well informed. Not that I'm bragging, but I was obsessed. So I'd read the Telegraph and the Guardian every day just to get the, mind you, it's, you know, not that much different these days. And, you know, the Spectator and, I don't know, the Statesman and a few things. And I was obsessed with politics. I suppose that comes back to my... to my background and leaving the, I'm originally from Serbia or from Yugoslavia, as it was called then, and I didn't leave, I was in London visiting my brother when the war started in Yugoslavia, civil war, and I stayed because I was drafted for the army and I didn't want to take part in the whole thing, so I just stayed. And then the war went on for a few years and I was obsessively trying to get all the information about the, everything that's going on, and you know, and hence my obsession with the news and the politics in general, I think. But I've gone off because I'm old enough to kind of realize certain things, and you know, but
you can't, you,
well, whatever it is, you know, we're not going to go into politics now. We don't have time.
We don't have time. Maybe I can ask you about this work,
please.
Though, if you'll
indulge
me. The one we're sitting amongst. Because, I mean, there's some gnomes and gnome-like. I'm not sure if, you know, garden ornaments, I suppose.
Yeah, garden ornaments.
Gnomes and other sundry garden ornaments on the outside. And then there's a border. And then there's some more coming in, and there are crossroads.
Yeah.
I mean, one can see the analogy that one could take from that. Was that a purposeful thing?
Yeah,
and,
I hope
you've
so.
Used gnomes before.
I mean, it wasn't, no, of course, but it's not that obvious. But the idea, my idea was to, because these are made in Serbia, and I saw a place where they're selling, I mean, I'm sure they sell them in England and in Germany, wherever there is kind of gardens and people with bad taste. I'm sure there is lots of gnome shops. Well, whatever, you know, I was scared of them when I was a kid because I saw them as, I don't know, just scary, sinister, probably this, you know, similar size, and they were quite freaky. But I saw them in Serbia, and then I had an idea of bringing them over as kind of a, I mean, funnily enough, they were brought to England in the back of a truck on the semi kind of fake papers because they were not classified as art. I wrote a statement to say that I was moving from Serbia to England, and they were my possessions, so in a way they were fake papers. So I like the connection between the refugees and the back of the truck. I mean, it's not, you know, it's not a kind of jokey thing, because refugees, I'm sure, don't enjoy being transported, you know. I don't know if these guys enjoyed it or not, but they were brought, you know, to England legally, but
in my
mind, semi-legally, and I did this piece. I had another piece with gnomes in the museum, but it changed from the original idea. It doesn't matter. But this one is like a line of, I don't know, you know, they could be refugees or some kind of immigrants who are coming in and intruding on this kind of...
On your show?
On my show, yeah. I mean, I welcomed them. I invited them, but I didn't know if they're going to be welcomed or not. That's up to,
and the
people
signpost?
To decide. The signpost...
Because these point to, so these are names of some of the works. So
yeah,
this work is
they
called
do.
Happy, Happy
point.
Hour.
They are just titles of the... works on a signpost. I mean, it's referencing all the sign. While I was doing my residency here, I have a dog, so I was walking the dog a lot, and there are lots of signposts, the countryside. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are lots of signposts in London, but they're different.
But there's certainly quite a plaintive look on those cats' face.
Yeah, well, they're trying to work out, maybe they don't understand the language.
True.
I don't know.
There's also, you talked about, like, you know, that the gnomes are, I suppose, I want to be on careful ground here, but synonymous with a certain taste. And there's a slight...
Well, taste is a slippery thing.
Of course,
you
but,
know, it's,
there's,
I'm not saying, yeah.
They, let's just say, I can't imagine that the designers of the wonderful garden out the back there at any point thought, let's get some gnomes in. And
I'm sure Pete didn't have that in mind.
Maybe, yeah. But
he did like these, I think, as an idea. Not in his garden, obviously, but I wish I could extend them into his garden and jumping into the pond. Mm-hmm. But
I suppose my general point is that there's an impish desire to just mess with things, be it putting a rose in Bambi's bottom.
I don't know if that's messing. It's, you know, our art is a...
There's a certain humour in the work. No?
Well, yeah. To an extent, I think there is all... I mean, most of my works has a certain element of humour, or some are kind of cynical in a way, but I don't think that's not the message I'm trying to, send. But there is an element of that, and that's just... I think it comes from who I am and how I see things.
Mm-hmm.
So cynicism, I suppose, comes with age, and experience and humor just comes naturally, I suppose. But there is, but that's not a starting point.
Mm-hmm.
But it creeps in, I would say, into the works.
There's certainly like an idea of like juxtaposition, whether it's the desecration or what have you, a childhood favorite, or a very sinister looking gentleman over there. But with sort of peace and love, flower power, makeup on.
Yeah.
That there's a tension, I suppose, there.
Yeah. Well, I hope there is, but, you know. Some works, I used to kind of really not be, or try not to be political in my works. And intentionally, and
art
is so varied, and different people deal with different things, and, you know, from whatever gender, color, you know, gesture to I don't know. I mean, it goes on and on. And politics wasn't, I never
your
allowed politics.
Subject is.
Well, it was, I didn't allow it in.
Yeah.
Because I thought it would spoil the, not that I didn't feel strongly about politics, but I didn't want to give my opinions through art. Mm-hmm. I tried to keep it politics free.
Yes,
to say.
Yeah.
But it's I think slowly it's starting to kind of creep in a way. Not consciously again, but I think subconsciously. So I think there are certain pieces that are more political than the others.
Mm-hmm.
Not obviously, but they are dealing with some of my opinions, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And that one was one of those, but in a kind of obscure way.
Mm-hmm.
But the title plays on with the image, and the image itself has got two different, completely different things. But it's with this particular piece, I think it was some kind of disappointment or disillusionment. I don't know.
With,
but again, I don't know if that's important to
of course
kind
yeah.
of talk about,
because I mean
because ultimately the you know, it's there. And if
doesn't need to know.
No. And I mean, think so. I mean, I know people like to have the explanations and people like to have, you know, to know what's going on. And I think that's in my work, that could be slightly problematic because some of the shows I had previously, some people assumed that it was a group show, you know, because of the different ways of making the stuff and different subject matter in the paintings. And but I quite like that. I mean, that's the way it works. So I don't, you know, I don't personally don't have a problem with that. Mm-hmm. But I can see it as a problem from the point of view of the audience. And I don't, again, I don't mind that. Okay. Even if it's problematic, you know, that's how I work. And right? Yeah, and it's not a bad thing from my point of view necessarily, because I think maybe it's more interesting. But I do understand the people's need to have the explanation and to understand. And but as I said, I do care about the visual look. Mm-hmm. So disregarding everything else, mm-hmm. I quite like the it's very important for me how it looks as well in the end. I mean, it sounds a bit kind of
I always see it as a sort of looking around at your work as a sort of, there's an obvious joy in painting, in the thing of doing.
Yeah.
Like, you know, so I get the brush mark, the paint handling.
Yeah.
The brush handling, if you want to use one of those great sort of painterly critic terms.
Yeah.
Is very different in this work as opposed to this work. But that feels like a sort of exuberance of like...
Yeah.
Making it, and going back to the sculptures, the deities of like testing.
It is, unless you, I think with anything, I mean, that's a subjective, as I said, my view, but I think unless you enjoy it to an extent, I mean, it can't be all enjoyment, of course, but unless you enjoy what you're doing, you might as well do something else that you enjoy.
Well, yes.
You know, I know it's easy to say.
yeah. No, absolutely.
You know, art is another profession.
Yes.
You know, especially these days, it's, I mean, it always was. You work as the banker or a baker or everyone else. You know, you've got a profession and you work, you know. But the freedom is there that maybe in other jobs you don't have.
Mm-hmm.
But then the decision making is on you. You know, it's. Where were we again? Sorry,
I keep wandering
off.
I wanted to ask you about sort of a question of exhibition making.
Yeah.
Because there's a prevalent. I mean, let's talk about these two most recent shows.
Yeah.
There's a very prevalent idea of exhibition making. You know, there's elements that are. You know, the signposts, the painted walls. Sure, they're works, but they're also ideas of installation and kind of doing something different as opposed to just a series of paintings and sculptures. In Holborn, presumably you were given the option of, here's your room, put your paintings up.
Yeah. I found it more interesting with that particular one to respond to to the collection there, but I usually, these two last two shows were different in a way because I knew the space, and in Holborn, I mean, in that case, I directly responded to the given kind of thing, and here I had the layout in mind and the galleries, and I was working down the road, so I was here, you know, every few days. Mm-hmm. So I had the space in mind. I don't, before these two shows, I don't think I've ever made work for a specific space.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I don't know to what extent it works or it doesn't work. You know, I'm still kind of thinking and looking back. But I usually just make work and then install in the given space and edit and see how it's, I mean, it's fairly straightforward generally in galleries,
of course,
because you get the
I mean, these are quite wide unusual spaces.
Well, especially this one is a bit tricky, I think. Not tricky, but different in a way.
It's a barn.
It's a barn, and then you don't know how, paintings in a barn. I mean, objects, fair enough, because you can centralize them and put them in the, and then it's safer in a way. But paintings, I don't know. So it was a challenge to an extent,
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe at the point of challenge, we could challenge everyone around us.
Challenge, yeah.
And ask. Challenge if there's any questions. Challenge.
That's challenge. Not a challenge. That's just a part of the conversation.
That microphone here, so if anyone wants to use that.
Okay, I'll ask
Johnny.
I didn't have a question prepared for you or anything.
Okay, you came unprepared. That's really bad.
This is the second time I've heard you talk about your work.
Yeah.
And
is it different than the first
time?
A little bit.
But kind of one of the words that keeps kind of popping into my head that you never say is chaos.
Chaos in the work.
You never mention chaos kind of generally, but it does seem to be kind of like an undercurrent in your work. It's something that kind of like creeps into every level of your making, kind of like your work processes, stream of consciousness.
Yeah.
And the chaos in itself is kind of an interesting idea because it's a rejection of a singular reading.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to.
It's a point, but good point, I think, because that's the way I work and that's the way I try to keep it working, until it works. But I'm quite chaotic by nature in terms of everything I do. It's not a organized and a structured kind of life. I mean, it is to an extent now with the family and everything, but work.
With you, isn't it?
I think it is. It's a rejection of, and the eclectic approach to painting and the works of art is intentional.
Yeah.
I try to keep everything. I mean, however lame it sounds, I try not to think, to overthink things, and especially in the process of making art or coming up with the ideas, I try to keep it as chaotic. That's a right word. I was going to say as eclectic, but it's not, it's not, because inevitably, subconsciously, you'll get to some kind of structure, even if it's a chaos structure, but do you feel chaos. You see what I mean?
If you were pinned down to kind of like a single sort of maybe kind of didactic sort of reading of your work, it would kind of be like death,
chaos,
kind of in a way.
Yeah, probably. I'm getting old.
Chaos is a strategy to kind of avoid a singular kind of model reading.
Well, hopefully.
Yeah.
I'll postpone it for a few years.
Yeah.
You put in structures,
the career death and the real death. Sorry,
but you instill structures into your work to imbue chaos, the books, the randomness of those things.
But inevitably, you can't, unless you have psychological problems, which unfortunately I don't have. I think you can't be so really chaotic. It's impossible.
You see what I mean?
There's got to be something, some kind of thing happening in your head that's not normal to be genuinely chaotic, I think.
But one can fight against order.
Yeah.
Even if one doesn't succeed.
Yeah, of course. Well, you can reject the order in a way. And we were talking earlier and I said I'm quite schizophrenic in the approach to things. And I like this and this. Things that are not compatible, but that's just the way, and I like to keep it that way because for me it's more interesting, and I'm trying to make it more interesting than through what I'm doing in art. I don't know if I'm succeeding or not, but that's up to the others to say, but
because naturally as a human being one like ends up channeling oneself.
Yeah.
Of course. I mean, you end up saying, I don't like action films.
Yeah.
I only love rom-coms.
Of course. But
one starts to... But you seem to be wanting I want action films and Love Actually.
Yeah, exactly. Love Actually. Not really, but not that particular one. Love Actually 2. Is there a sequel? Perfect. No, but yeah, I try to keep it, you know, and I try to, but I also, all my life, I think I kind of, not knew, but I was open to different things, and I would, through that openness, I would embrace certain things that were more interesting or more appealing to me. Mm-hmm. And they were really, eclectic. Mm-hmm. And I never narrowed it down, and I was, I don't know, that's just my view of the world. I find things from different places, you know, if they're interesting, they're interesting for a reason, not, you know, I wouldn't necessarily reject them because they're from different culture that I don't understand, or, you know, then I try to understand the thing to, and it's either even more appealing or I realize I don't, but I do give it a benefit of the doubt, or I do give it a chance to kind of, you know, I never had a structure of, or I don't know what's the, in English, how would you say the small town mentality or whatever it is. I'm not saying I'm a man of the world by any means or anything like that, or this is better than, you know, home, work, pub, whatever, you know, in a small town. I mean, in Britain, I'm not saying that's, it sounds great.
Yeah.
You know, I had it for a few months and it was brilliant. So I'm not saying this is better than that. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying my approach is different. So after this, I wouldn't stay here, or, you know, and I didn't stay in where I come from. I didn't stay because it was time to move on. And at the same time, I do understand people who stay in places that they're, you know, in a comfort zone, and they're not interested in what comes from Guatemala. You know, and it's fine. I'm sure it's fine.
Without putting you on the couch, of course, this is
But I'm just saying, who was forced to move. There are different approaches to life.
Of course.
And it's, you know, in my experience, it's all valid in a way. Everyone has their own thing. Any more questions?
Yes. I'm sure we're here for your problems.
Sorry, what's your name, sir?
I'm Stefan.
Oh, okay. Hi, Stefan.
We work together on the book. I wanted to ask you, I found it quite interesting that sometimes you just start with the title, and that's what drives the work. And so I wanted to ask you about the title of the book, and sort of where it comes from. Just generally, it's your process of titling.
That's an obvious one, isn't it? It's questions of faith. It's like faith in general, but faith in what you do, faith in, you know, the intention, faith in people, faith in the world in general, faith in art. So it's kind of questioning, you know, I mean, it's implying that the work is questioning everything, but any artwork is questioning some things to an extent, I would say.
Yeah.
So I thought it was appropriate to cover that body of work, because even if that wasn't the original intention, questioning, I'm sure that comes in, you know, if you're questioning yourself. I mean, it can go on, and, you know, the questions can...
Yeah. One needs a leap of faith to...
Hopefully everyone needs...
We have a leaping gnome out there.
Yeah, well, that's a leap of faith.
That's a leap of faith.
Is he...
Whether he's foolish or not, so it's another matter.
Yeah.
There must be any more questions? We're here to...
Don't worry. Please.
For your problems.
Microphone.
Djordje's here to help you. Life episodes.
I enjoyed your explanation on chaos. It was much different than Brian Cox, which was completely different. But as I sit here and I look at your the signpost, which is in a sense chaotic to which direction you could be going in, what direction do you see yourself going, you know, as you look forward, which, you know, where do you see yourself going? And is that chaotic, or would you say that you've seen a glimpse of something that you'd like to sort of pursue?
It's chaotic in a way that I don't know where I'm going, but I have some inclination. I try to kind of keep it fresh, as I call it. I don't know if it works or it doesn't work or if it's successful or not. But I do get, when I'm making a painting, when it's a figurative painting, I'm giving you an example to illustrate my point, where I'm going. I do make a series of these paintings where something is kind of shown, a specific thing, recognizable image. And I do get tired of that, and then I would just pull a canvas and do an abstract painting. So I'm getting more into that, or maybe I'm getting tired of all of these works in a way that are, you know. I think as I get older, I think I try to think even less. So I think the direction, I can't tell you for certain because I don't know until I go to the studio and see where it takes me. But there are no plans, but you know, it might be just a gestural kind of work for a while, I think. But again, I don't know.
Do you think about these characters as having personalities?
As my children.
As your children?
No, I do in a way, yeah.
Yeah.
I do in a way, but, you know, you can't get too attached to them because you'd suffer emotionally. I mean, for them, you know, you'd feel for them, so.
Like, walking around here, there's a lot of characters. In fact, I just suddenly had that recollection of the end scene of Who Framed Roger Rabbit, when the curtain is, and the chaos, the joyful, brilliant chaos comes in. And I have that same joy.
That's a postmodernist nightmare in itself, yeah.
Walking around.
Who Framed Roger Rabbit, yeah.
But there's, I mean, you return to these kind of, you return to these characters, you return to these sort of motifs, or at least a type of motif, a kind of, you take something from high culture, low culture.
Yeah.
Do you think about how they'll get on? Or, like, almost
not
as
really.
Characters?
No. Not really. I don't think about that. I would say low culture, high culture, you know, left wing, right wing. It doesn't, in today's world, I don't see that as a kind of a significant distinction in a way that I would be concerned with.
Because it's not useful, or it doesn't exist?
I don't, it exists less and less, I would say, you know? And I mean, high culture, low culture, that's, you know.
That's...
You can say that the opera is high culture because few of the people know the story of the opera, and they can follow and they understand the language and they know why it's, you know, why it goes up at certain moments, the tension and everything. But, you know, some people see it as completely ridiculous thing, and I see both points as completely valid. I mean, to an extent, it's higher culture, but to an extent, it's just a ridiculous, you know, thing where you have usually big guys singing as loud as they can,
and
acting out something. I mean, there are usually, to be fair, really nice and beautiful stories behind it, but you have to know those things. And if you're culturally not prepared for these things, or you haven't had any contact with them, you see them as the opera buff would see the neighbors or something. Or maybe, I mean, these days I'm sure they cross over at some points, you know, but you would call the soaps low culture or whatever popular, and this is like, you know, we drink champagne at Goldburn. What is the opera place called?
The Royal Opera House? No,
it doesn't matter. But, you know, it's, I don't see a... It's a point of view that's doesn't have the same kind of resonance as it had 100 years ago.
But it's also the saturation of images right now.
Probably. With the internet and the whole thing.
I mean, I can't remember the last time I watched the film Bambi, but the amount of times I've seen the image of Bambi.
Yeah. Well, it's used for different.
I mean, I must see it like, I don't know, 10 times a year.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah, probably.
Like, I haven't watched the film since.
Of course, it lingers kind of somewhere.
And there seems to be like to capture them.
Yeah.
You know what? Yes.
Please.
How long did this body of work take you?
You
said you were here 3 months.
No, I was here from June, beginning of June, till, help me out.
The, 6 months.
Yeah, 6 months. No, not, well, 6 months on and off. I was off, and then I would come back. But I prepared 2 shows, so this took me 2 months, I would say, this show.
And you work on many paintings simultaneously?
I did for this show. I usually kind of am too keen to finish the painting in order to start a new one that, I can't really leave it.
And you said that you cast some of those, I presume?
No, those are all made by me, by hand. Everything from that room to the end. I mean, not this room and... the small pieces were... No, sorry, of course. That piece is sourced from different places and then cast by someone else and molded, I mean, cast in resin, colored resin by someone else. But I chose the pieces. You know, I did the...
Why resin?
Editing. Why resin? Because I worked with resin a lot, and I quite like the finish of that. It looks like a plastic toy, and they're cast with in resin, but with pigments mixed with resin, so they're not painted as such. They have different, slightly look, and I quite like that material. And I used it before I had some African masks that I casted then in bright colors and changed the kind of visual and conceptual approach to that, but
the synthetic sort of nature removes it from that,
completely from the wooden. But they do look wooden because they're cast from wooden. Mm-hmm. All of those pieces were wooden. Well, thank you all very much for coming. Thank you for the questions. Really,
I just want to say thank you,
please.
Djordje, very much. Thank you, Oliver, very much. Can you join me in?
Thank you. No, thank you all for coming.